Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. In today's video, we continue, or well, essentially we start a new playlist in our channel with the name RAG, Retrieval Augmented Generation. This is a series of videos that I'm gonna do about this topic. There is some videos already there, so I will group them in the same playlist. And today we are gonna review and introduce a new technology with the name GraphRAG from Microsoft. This is a tool which essentially is it's a suite of the data extraction and transformation components with the help of AI tool, LLM, is able to improve the interpretation and search capabilities of a RAG agent. How Microsoft is doing that, how RAG is doing that, is essentially creating a knowledge graph from the data that you provide as input to the knowledge graph. So what is the basis of the aim of that? Now, as you probably know, when you create an agent, a RAG agent, which essentially has as well the aim to to optimize the output of the large language model, so with the help of or introducing or helping the LLM with some additional context, and providing this information together with the question that that you formulate to the LLM, the LLM is going to be able to provide a more accurate answer. You can do this either providing some examples like we do with the few soft prompting, or connecting to different sources like via APIs, via loading some documents, via searching in internet or searching in a database, or connecting to a GRAD database. Many ways to enrich or provide context to the LLM to provide a more suitable answer to the questions that you formulate, especially in those cases that you are asking information about some private data that which was not used to train the model, which is many of the industry cases that we cover with this technology. You probably know all the LLMs, whatever, it doesn't matter if it is commercial or non-commercial, are training with a dataset, and then on everything that is outside of that dataset, especially private data or company data, is not contained in that on those datasets. And also information or events that happen after the day that the model was trained and released, this information is not included on the LLM, and the LLM on the information that the LLM was exposed, and this the LLM is unable to answer you correctly to the question. That's why came into a scene technologies or techniques like RAG, which help the LLMs or to build agents and applications which help the LLM. That and using this additional information with this unknown for them, provide using the power of the training and the capabilities that had the LLM been this way, they will be able to give you an accurate response. So, what is the problem with the approach that we will be we will be following up to now using technologies like vector stores or similar? Well, the problem with that is when we use a technology like a vector store to keep Data or information that is private information or private data that that was not used to train the LLM. This information is chunked, no? Is we divide or split information in small chunks, and we create for this chunks embeddings that we later on store in a vector store. Later on, once we have the information stored there, we use a technology like LangChain, Llama Index or similar, or the semantic kernel from Microsoft as well, to using an LLM query this vector store, information store. Is in form of the vectors of the embeddings, and retrieve parts of this text or these documents which are relevant to the information or to the question that we are formulating to the application or to the agent. In the current approach, and I'm circumventing only these two information that is included in a vector store, and then on less part from now what we had in databases or via APIs or via other techniques. Just let's imagine that we are taking some documents included in a vector store, and then we use this vector store to provide context to the LLM to answer you more accurately to the questions that you are formulating. With the current approach, we use either cosine similarity or semantic similarity to retrieve the more similar or documents or chunks of these documents that are able to that are able to answer the question that you formulate. How we retrieve these documents, as I said, we use either semantic similarity or cosine similarity, Euclidean similarity, and an algorithm which tells us that how close are the question that you formulate to the chunks that you had on the vector store. That's why we embed the chunks that we create from our documents into embeddings, and then when you formulate a question, we create an embedding using the same technology that you use to create the embeddings from the chunks, and then you using a similarity algorithm, you compare your question versus all the embeddings, all the vectors embeddings that you have on the database. Usually later on, you using a ranking and logic, you return to the user a number of documents that in the next step you will use as a context to be provided to the LLM. And with this context, the LLM will build the final answer. The problem with that is when you are just this technology, regardless how it's done, semantic similarity, Euclidean distance, cosine similarity, they are gonna retrieve and return only those documents that are similar or the most similar, or the chunks that are more similar to the question that you formulate. They are not usually these embeddings, they are individual vectors which they can have some metadata which can enrich the filtering process and the retrieval process, but in few words, they are not quite connected even in between them. They are independent vectors which they can be more or less similar to the question that you formulate. What means that they are not interconnected in between them, and not interconnected, for example, to the global topics that the document or documents that you introduce into the vector store have. So there is no relations in between the content of the individual chunks and embedding vectors in between them. And there is no relations and no interconnections. That's why the reason of introducing what we know in the process as a knowledge graph. What is going to do a knowledge graph? Cover this gap, no? There is a caveat in this process that we don't have relations and connections in between the different chunks, and then when we retrieve documents and from a vector store, we are going to retrieve those documents that are very similar to the question that you formulate. But if you make a global question, for example, okay, tell me about the topic of the and sorry, summarize in few lines the what is the content of all these documents that you had, even when the LLM is able to do it, at the end is going to retrieve 5-10 more closed documents, and it will build the answer with the documents that the technology has retrieved from the vector store. And these documents are individual chunks from one or many documents that you introduce on the vector store. There is no relations in between them. Creating, in the other hand, a knowledge graph, what you are going to have is, first of all, you will have the same number, same chunks, but a part of the chunks of the text or the documents, you will have, you will discover what we name entities that are the like names, locations, actions that are the key components of every chunk, and then on relations in between these different entities that you find in this chunk and in other chunks, you create connections and relations in between the entities that you discover in a chunk and the entities the same or others that you have in other chunks, and finally you create a communities of these relations organized by topic. What we are doing there is, at the end of the process, we had a complex graph where we have entities, which are the main concepts that are that contains the documents that we use to create the graph, and relationships in between the context are kind of what we have, the ontologies of the entities and relations that we have in our documents mapped to the different chunks or text that compose all the documents that we load to the knowledge graph. And then this way this knowledge graph is going to be able to retrieve not only the individual components and relevant information that contain any individual chunk, also the global concepts and global facts and meanings that can explain what is included in the document or documents that we use to create a knowledge graph. Doing that as well, when we use a retrieval store with this capabilities and knowledge graph bucket, the LLM will receive a more granular and suitable information together with entities and relationship between this, and the LLM will get a more accurate and adequate information to be able to later answer you the question that you want to that you formulate. And this is essentially how GraphRAG was designed. No? We are going to create a a knowledge graph from documents, and then we will create this knowledge graph using an LLMs, multi-par LLMs. And once we have the knowledge graph created, we will use this knowledge graph to answer questions or create questions, follow-up questions in a conversation that we had with a LLM. Similarly to what we do with a vector store in a RAG component. And then on as the basis in this how it works, I have prepared a notebook. As usual, where I will explain the different phases that we have when we use when using the GraphRAG technology, and how later on I will do a small demo in querying and using the information that we had that contains that is contained in the knowledge graph, and using an LLM create some questions about the information that is contained in the knowledge graph. So essentially, the knowledge graph to create a knowledge graph in with GraphRAG and to be able later on to use it in a RAG component. There is two phases. One is the initialization, and the other one is the creation of the knowledge graph itself. In the initialization, essentially create the basis. You pass essentially a document or documents or a folder which contains the different documents in a format, and the technology GraphRAG is going to create some prompts. There is these documents, these TXT files which contain prompts that I will show you in right away, containing few short prompting with instructions and some examples of how an LLM had to use the had to find the information inside the chunks of the documents that you have created. First of all, it will be a process of chunking the document, and then on we will apply these prompts in a sequence in order to build the knowledge graph. So in the initialization, we create what we say these prompts in a folder. Prompts, you will find that we will review that, and we will create as well, or the process of the initialization, create a YAML file which contain all the steps and paths and models that you are going to use during the creation of the knowledge graph. So apart of that, it also contains a .m file, which is essentially used to you include the keys. In this case, you have an entry with the NGRAD API key where you will have to place, in my case, or in this example, we are going to use OpenAI SDK. You can use as well Azure OpenAI SDK, so you have to put in the GraphRAG API key entry the key to you access to the SDK. So you have as well here all the definition of your encoding model, the model that you are going to use. You have here in your case that you want to set up some default parameters. All these parameters can be later on overwrite using the SDK and the classes in the SDK of GraphRAG. Parallelization, if you want to use asynchronous mode or not asynchronous mode, the embeddings technology you want to use, in this case the test embedding small, also the parameters, the size of the chunks, and then if you are going to do some overlap, this is very similar to what we do with LangChain or Llama Index. So how we are going to divide, split our text, and if there is an overlap between the previous and the next chunk in order to contain some how to say relation, kind of physical relation in the in between the different chunks, and then on what is going to be the column that we will use to make the relation among the different tables that we are going to create, containing entities, relationships, and other extractions that we will do from the test during the creation of the knowledge graphs. Knowledge graph. The input, our input folder, the cache also to keep temporary files. Also we had, for this we can use either local file or Azure Blob Store. Also where we are going to keep our spores, the reports. Reports is all the login, where you will see all the different steps, all the login, the login that is produced during the initialization process and also during the knowledge graph creation process. As well, we have here how we are going to extract the entities, summarize the descriptions, summarize the claims, how to create the community reports, and then on here you provide first of all a prompt that later on you can modify as well, which entities you want to extract. We will cover this right ago, and the number of iterations that you want to go through this process. You can create go several paths through the information to in an iterative process. In this case it's going to do only one, but you can do several times. For example, you set up mask clearing 3, you will go over every document more 3 times up to the LLM either is convinced that there is no more entities that can be extracted from that chunk, or the process get the maximum. In this case, if you set that to three iterations. Summarizations, again, there is another prompt that you can modify as well. Maximum length of the summary, number of claims. Two claims is kind of the relevant facts that you can extract from one or two entities and relations. We'll cover this as well with the looking at the prompts, and also how to create the community reports. Community reports, after that we have created the entities, summarize and claims, then on we group, we use a hierarchical clustering algorithm to create communities of the nodes, or in this case the nodes are the entities with the relations, and then on from those communities of nodes or communities of entities we create a summary which explain what all these nodes which are related in between them, or strongly related, how you can explain what is these entities and relations are doing. So you have to keep in mind as well that all these entities, descriptions, claims, nodes, relations, etc. are mapped back to chunks of text which contain an ID. This is what we are doing essentially on the chunking phase. So we map entities to ID chunks, or which are part of the text, relations as well, summary descriptions, claim extractions, community report, everything is interconnected using the ID of every individual chunk. Finally, how many community, how many clusters you are going to do, in the clusters of nodes or entities. What more, and how you can set up finally the local sets and global sets. We will cover this after explaining the prompts. If we look at the prompts, we have here, we are essentially providing an instruction to the LLM how from a specific chunk is going to extract some entity types that we had defined in the settings YAML file. Here is providing some examples. Here is a kind of few shot prompting that this is one of the documents that is generated during the initialization. You can modify before running the process or the second step, where you essentially index all the documents and create the knowledge graph. This is the prompt to create the entities. This is the prompt to create the summaries. Again, here is just providing a summary for an entity, etc. Claim extraction, claim, as you can see, take an action or like a fact in the chunk and create a description of this enrich with this the knowledge graph. No? You can see as well here some examples. Entity organization, client description, the text that where you find this, for example, is an organization reflex associated with the entity. You can see here according to the article, blah blah blah, company A was fine for a peer rigging. Well, and then on you produce company A, the limit government agency B, anti-competitive practice, etc. So you are creating kind of relevant pieces of information in an structured way that later on you can use to enrich or find different informations in your knowledge graph when you formulate a question. And the final is the community reports, that is from every cluster of the entities, or in this case node, the entities that we discover for nodes, we interconnect nodes with different relations, and then on in the final process, I will explain now all the process, using a hierarchical clustering algorithm, communities of nodes, in this case according to the settings we are going to create 10, and then on from this you create a summary with this format, and then on these summaries will be used later on the global search mostly to create context to answer or to help to answer the LLM questions that covers all the documents or have to consider all the information or relevant or all the information contained in your documents. You can see here some examples as well. So all these are templates that are created during the initialization process, and then on you can modify them at your convenience, especially the entity extraction one, because here, for example, not the templates, but you can include as well some of your material, but during the creation of the knowledge graph, what is gonna use the GraphRAG is what you have set up in your YAML file and in combination with the prompt that you have defined here. Again, you can modify the template, but you have to be consistent with what you are with what you have in your YAML file. Okay, so the process essentially end to end, as I said, is first of all, there is a phase of the indexing. We do the initialization where we create the prompts and the YAML file. We tailor these files to our needs, and then on. The first thing that we are going to do is a text unit segmentation. This is chunking the documents, and then on the size of the documents, bigger the chunk, it will be capturing more entities from that chunk. If you create very small chunks, it's going to be very difficult to capture different entities and different relationships in between these entities. So we need to find a trade-off in between the number of entities and the time that is going to take to extract these entities or find these entities from the document from every chunk and the size of that chunk. If you create again very small chunks, first of all you are going to do a lot of the calls as well to the in this case to the OpenAI SDK. This will produce a increase the cost, and then you will not be able to create many relationships and extract many meaningful entities and relationships from that chain. So here, by the way, I forgot to tell you that there is a document created by Microsoft, Microsoft Research, which is the all the explanations of what I'm explaining here. I'm not inventing anything, it's not coming. It's just I will pass you later on as well. It's included on the head of this notebook, the reference to this and also to the algorithm that we used to do the Leiden algorithm to create to do the semantic hierarchical clustering to create the clusters of communities on the final phase. I will explain now. So here you had the different phases, how it's created, how create the communities, the sub-communities at level one, so the how we do the hierarchical clustering of communities and in the final phase of the indexing. So again, we chunk the documents after chunking the documents. What we do is extract entities, relationships and claims, and then once we had all this stuff, as I mentioned and as I show you, we are using the LLM, in this case OpenAI GPT-4 Turbo. You can use other. I'm still digging into the documentation to understand if we are able to use public LLMs, non-commercial LLMs. For the time being, I'm just using the example that Microsoft provide, and then I'm using, I didn't modify too much the default settings. But I assume that it will be able to use. I commend you that because the process, just to prepare this video, I spent $15 in with a small document, and then it's a very expensive process, and you have to keep this in mind. It's also warned, they also warned that it's an expensive operation to do this. And then, but well, in the next video, I will have the I will be covered. The documentation is quite extensive about GraphRAG. It's a now very hot topic in the industry. And then when I didn't have all the time, I just wanted to do an introduction to the topic. So first of all, again, we do the chunking. We extract entities, relationships, and claims using our prompts. Everything, again, is doing leveraging all the extraction this extraction process with the help of LLMs and fuse of prompting with the prompts that are created by default as templates for the tool, for GraphRAG. And after that, we apply the hierarchical clustering using the Leiden technique to perform hierarchical clustering on the initial knowledge graph that we have created with that. So after do the extraction, we create an initial, an initial knowledge graph with this initial knowledge graph is just simply connected the connections in between the different components using the ID. So this knowledge graph essentially is a one hierarchy, is a flat graph which contains nodes, which are the entities, relations, and some attributes that are in between Some attributes that are in between the nodes and relations that are the claim instructions. So after the phase two, after we are finishing the element summaries, we have a flat graph without any how to say clustering. So all the nodes, we have a knowledge graph because we have connections in between the different entities, different claims, different, there is different relationship with different attributes, but this is mapped back using the IDs of the chunks to the text, but all the nodes are kind of the individual nodes that are not grouped by meaningful or global topics. That's why we later on we apply this hierarchical clustering to first of all create communities at different to create communities at different levels where we group the different nodes and relationships using this techniques that with the name LADIN. In this LADIN, discover communities structured inside the graph, and each cluster entities of each clusters are assigned to different communities for a more deep analysis. So you probably know that community is a group of nodes where inside the within the graph that are densely connected to each other, but sparsely connected to other groups into the graph. So we are grouping, creating different communities, different groups of nodes at different levels, which later on are going to give us a different view or perspective of the information that we have inside the knowledge graph. Once we have these communities, graph communities done at different levels, if you can, where is this? There is the gem. We create three, so 10 different, maximum 10 clusters that this can be overwrite as after in during the creation, but by default it's going to create this this number. But once we have this, what we do, or what the tool is doing, is creating a summary of this community. The summary of the community is what we saw here, is we had a cluster of nodes with their relationships, and we ask the LLM to create a summary of what is contained in this group of entities and relationships with, as you know, they are mapped back through the ID to different chunks on the on your of your text. And this is the final phase, and once we have the community summaries, we can start to do we can start querying the knowledge graph. So at the best is to do a test or the, or show you how it works. So this phase, the community summary generation, per each community and his member, we use a bottom-up approach, and this we create the summaries, which include the main entities in the community, the relationships, and the key claims. No? And this gives us an overview of the entire data set. It provides a very powerful contextual information for the next queries or the subsequent queries that we are going to do. And then again, the best thing is to see how this works in an example, and then on I will show you now how this is working in a real case. We are going to use for creating the knowledge graph document. This is a book, The Great Gatsby, something that we use in different cases in the channel for other purposes, to do document summarization, and well, in some of the videos of the channel we already use this book. Great Gatsby, and then on here I pass you the libraries that you need to do. We are going to use, in this case, Milbus Vector Database. In the Milbus Vector Database, we are going to introduce the different chunks of vectors and the relationships in between them. Later on, in the final stage, after so what we introduce on the Milbus vectors are the chunks with their embeddings. To later on, the graph tool is going to use one side the some tables that it will create with all the information that contains produce the creation of the knowledge base, and in the vector database we are going to introduce the unit text, the chunks, with their respective embeddings. So we install everything we need, the PY Milbus and the GraphRAG. This is a branch which had the connection created with Milbus. By default, this is working with the search technology of Microsoft Azure. So if you want to use it with a non-commercial database like Milbus, you have to use this branch. You install here Future, a library you need, and also python.bin to load the environment in memory. We create here the folder where we will keep all our knowledge graph and artifacts produced during the process, and here we just read the book. The book, as I show you, is the Great Gatsby. Is a document with 6,000, practically 7,000 lines. It's a long document. Again, it costs a little bit money. In the original example provided by GraphRAG, they use another book that was Shakespeare, and they use only 900 lines. So, yeah, keep in mind that the cost, because you try with many documents. So depending on what you have here. In your settings, here you access as input to type file, text files, input folder, and it's gonna take everything that you had in TXT, ending in TXT. So be careful what you put this. If you put 20 files, it will ingest 20 files, and then on. But I will show you now how this. What is happening under the hood, and you will see that every chunk for every chunk is applying all so entity extraction, then on apply summary clean extraction, summary descriptions, and finally after creating the communities they apply the community repos. So it's doing a lot of calls to the OpenAI SDK or the SDK of Azure OpenAI, and then you will have a huge bill if you introduce a lot of files. So here I just pass you some all the possibilities that you have on the tool, and here we just initialize the file, the graph. So once you initialize the graph, it's creating the prompts folder with all the prompts and also the settings.yaml and the .env file that later you will adjust or include or modify these files according to your needs. And after that you have done that, you can apply to run the indexing pipeline. The indexing pipeline, as I said, is defined here. The LLMs, the LLM and the embedding that you are going to use, and all the steps that you are going to do. And then as you can see here, it's a long process. It took approximately 15 minutes. And then on the output, you have the different. This is the initialization. So you can see here 1836, that was done yesterday and after the indexing. The indexing, if you go to reports, you have the logs, and then you can see here the configuration, and then on they start to do calls to OpenAI, okay, using the prompts that we have here defined, and then on here you have the cost. You can see here input tokens, output tokens, so you can add with a very huge call. Now here start merging graphs, creating summary entities, summary descriptions, more calls to create the community reports. So you can see here is a lot of the consumption of the of tokens, and finally is merging and creating some tables that are producing here on artifacts, some parquet files which essentially contains all the information that you have created during the process of indexing and creating the knowledge graph. So once the process is installed, we are going to review what has been created and do some local queries and global queries to using our knowledge graph. We define some paths, the name of the tables. Here we review the entity table. So we are using the embeddings, entity tables and entity embedding table. Both files are parquet. We create using the React indexer table. We are going to create the vector store, and we save it to local in amiibus.tv, and now we just simply extract take a look to the entities DF file. As you can see here, these are the entities that have been discovered: title, project file, the level, the type, description, source ID, the ID of the chunk, and some other information. We do the same with relationships. You can see here the relationship is in between project Gutenberg at the gray Caspi, the weight, description, text units IDs, where is included. It can be multiple, the ID of the chunk, etc. etc. Community reports. Again, this is everything extracted from the entities and relationships, and with the help of the LLMs, we are building this information. Text Unix, the same, with relationships, entities ID, documents ID, etc. You can see here there can be multiple documents as well, from where is coming from this ID. And now this is the information. Again, everything is created from one or multiple documents, and everything is stored in parquet file to later on you be able to use it. On the Vilnius, in the vector store, we introduce the entity DF and entity embeddings, embeddings DF. We create the embeddings as well during the creation. During the indexing process, and the only thing that we are doing here is saving these entities into the connection, into the Milbus database. Storage semantics embedding, using the storage entity semantics embeddings method. Okay, now there is two ways to query the knowledge graph using GraphRAG. One is global search and the other one is local search. Global search, as probably you can understand, is holistic question related to the whole data corpus, right? How we do that? Obviously using the community summaries. Why? Because the community summaries is the yeah, the summary, the resume of a number of entities that are in the that represent a part of the concepts and yeah, of the concepts that the LLM have extracted during the indexing process. You can see here are the steps. You use the conversational user story. You use the community report batches. You rank the intermediary response. Then finally you filter and rank in the intermediary response, and this is being used to create a final response. All this process as well is being leveraged by the use of an LLMs. Local search is also when you try to look for information related to a specific entity. And then on this way, if you point to a specific entity, is looking to the connections and of the neighbors that have these nodes, and the relationships of this entity with the neighbors has at different levels. So here, as you can see here, also we use the conversion, we extract the entities, we look from the mapping to different chunks of the text, we do the mapping with other entities, the relationships, and here we do a covariate entity mapping, and with this, with all this, is generating pieces of information that later on are going to be used create the context that we will send to the LLM to build the final response. Here you have the breakdown of all the steps that we will cover. Here we do a sample finally. We load our environment from the .env file. Here I have the OpenAI key as well. I'm going to use the GPTO. You can use the Turbo as well. And the embeddings model. The embeddings model has to be the same that you use here on your Yammer file. Text embedding small. And here essentially we create the LLM. It's a chat OpenAI object. Then we use as encoder the TikTok library with the model CL100K base. Again, it has to be the same that you use here. And then we create our embeddings model, the text embedder. We create the local share mixed context, what we are going to use. Community report, take units, entities, relationships, coverage is still not implemented. The entities embedding store, this is our Millbooks database store, the ID, which makes the relation among the different tables, the test embedder, and the token encoder. We create the parameters from the search. Again, this is on the by default, you had here something. As you can see, there is nothing, it's everything commented, and then we are using, we overwrite with all parameters. Parameters for the LLM, max number token 2000 and temperature 0. Here obviously apply all the parameters that you can set up for the chat OpenAI object. And then we use the local set class to create our search engine. LLM, context builder, token encoder, LLM parameters, context parameters, and the type of response. The type of response is a free text, and you can set up well how you want the LLM to respond to your answer. Single paragraph, multiple paragraph, report, blah blah blah. So how you want the LLM to respond. Now we are gonna do a question. Tell me about the Great Gatsby. You can see here. If you read the book, if you have read the book, you can review this or use your own context for something that probably you are more familiar with, and you can see how accurate is this answer. And then why? Because as I said, it's not only if we use a conventional RAG tool. When you ask about Great Gatsby, so essentially it's gonna get for example, if you use a TOK5 or return the TOK5 closest chunks of the that you had saved on the vector store. And then what happened? Well, with Great Gatsby, probably there is many chunks on the document, no? And then on, yeah, it had to choose five. It will size the with this description. Probably there is a lot of chance even that they had even cosine similarity. And then on, it's very hard to choose what is the best or the most accurate. But if you had other relationships, the first of all, you look into the community summaries, and then on, you can find other different entities that you can also include on your sets, and later on return different or additional chance to build the question, to build the response that that LLM will get you. You can see here, even it's pointing to different entities and relationships of the document. You can query your tables and see which exactly relationships as entities have been used for answering you. Here I'm asking another question about the relationship between Gatsby and Daisy Buchanan, and then again is asking you very accurately with how is connected these two entities, and is taking using all the information and all the connections and relations that you have in your knowledge graph. Other use is a question generation when you are interacting with an agent. Sometimes the agent is also can guide you in the next question that you may want to formulate, looking at the history of conversations that you have been done. And then on, you can create here with the local question generation another you use this class, you pass the LLM, the context builder, token encoder, parameters of the LLM and parameters of the context, you pass a history, and you generate questions. You ask the GraphRAG to generate next questions for using the history of your conversation. And then you can see here some candidates that you may answer, looking to what you have on the graph, in the knowledge graph, and looking as well to what you already have questioned to the to your LLM. And well, that's pretty much all. It's really, really interesting technology. In my opinion, this is the direction where many or most of the ages is going on, because well, this way we are capturing a more rich and granular relations and entities and information from our from the documents that we are providing to as context to be used in the interaction with our agent. And well, it's overcoming a lot of problems, or not problems, it's just that the technology it has some limitations in the way that the highway we can apply, for example, in the vector store some filtering to pre-filter using the metadata that you usually add to the embeddings. When we add documents to a vector store, we can add as well metadata. We can use this to pre-filter the documents before we retrieve the relevant or the more similar chunks to be used as context. But still, this is not able to get is probably more relevant information that if you don't use filtering, but in any case, it's not having the kind of the rich connections and relationships that we had using this knowledge graph on the way that we are using here. And okay, that's pretty much all. I will continue investigating that, and probably soon I will create another video. This time I will try to use a non-commercial LLM. I need to read some of the extensive documentation that we have here with in the repo, GraphRAG accelerator, which is another component. So there is a lot of going on, still not finished. I don't see that they have this as a solution that is already provided in the in Azure. And then I need to read a lot of stuff still to create a second, more rich video. This is only an introduction to show you what we had and how we can use it. I hope that it was useful and interesting for you. But again, we need to continue with that. As I said, I open a new section on the channel where I will group all the topic, all the videos I had about RAG and how to interact with or enrich or create agents to provide better response from our LLMs. And well, that is pretty much all for now. I hope that you find it useful and interesting and yeah, useful for your job, for your training, for whatever reason that you're watching these videos up to this point. And if so, just give me a like, subscribe to the channel, and make comments and all these kind of things to help me to grow on YouTube. I will upload now to the repo, and we also will point make some comments on the description of the video in order you to find it in the repository and be able to replicate all this stuff in your local environment. That's all. Thank you very much and see you soon.